Hello everyone, I welcome you all in this special session of GARP FRM Updates 2020 session. So there are updates released by the GARP on the 1st of December with the new learning outcome and the new curriculum changes. So we'll try to understand what are the changes, how it is going to affect you and what can you do to start your preparation in this case. Because the changes are very substantial for you, so you cannot use old books. This is the conclusion of these new updates. So first we will see what are the changes here. In the existing curriculum, so compared to 2019 and new 2020 session, which is available. First, you have the FRM Part 2 books are now curriculum books. Curriculum as in the GARP is providing you a single book, which is GARP's own book, kind of a curriculum book, instead of what was the previous style of giving you the books. Like the GARP used to recommend authors and you were supposed to read, say, 3 chapters from one author, 4 chapters from another author. And GARP used to compile those like author pages and then they used to give you as a GARP books. But now you have complete curriculum as per GARP's requirement and as per GARP's syllabus. So everything is the structure wise, everything is changed there now. You cannot match the title with the other books, the existing books. Then second is the FRM Part 2 books are still author recommended books. This is not a change. This is just a comparison what is happening with the FRM Part 2 book compared to FRM Part 1 book. In FRM Part 2, now new subject is introduced, which is a fourth subject, which is known as a liquidity, which is on the liquidity. And this subject is 50% new, 50% kind of old thing. There were few liquidity chapters, the chapters which are on the liquidity, and they were spread across all 5 subjects. Okay, now all these chapters are gathered together and they named it subject number 4 as a liquidity. And with that, they are adding 50% extra syllabus, right? So there are around 10 to 12 chapters. I'm not able to recall exactly how many chapters are there. Now, FRM Part 1 books are compulsory buy. So you have to buy it compulsorily. Your fees is increased. The exam fees is increased by $75. So you have to pay $75 extra and you will get books. Books are accessible via ebooks. Okay. So it is accessible only via your app. And I will also explain you or I will give you the feedback of that app. Then you have FRM Part 2 books are separate buy at $250 or $300 at the option. That is $200-$250 for the your ebooks and $300 for the printed books. Right. Now, what is the purpose of these changes as per the GARP? So this is as per GARP. OK, so for 2020, we again updated our study. This is to all those who participated in the surveys or who submitted a feedback to GARP that what should be changes. GARP reverted them, that is a risk managers, those are the FRMs, to them that what are the changes. Okay, so this is GARP's reply to FRMs and not for the students. So for 2020, we have again updated our study material to help candidates better prepare for exam and increase their chances of success. Increase their chances of success. First of all, success is like there is no such thing as increased chances of success, because anyway GARP is going to give you 35-40% result for FRM Part 1. So how it is affecting the chances of success, I don't know, because it is universally applicable for everyone, right? Then this year's changes were informed by the input received from risk managers like you. So this is the thing, like they are referring to risk managers and their responses to GARP's global practice analysis. Okay, so these are just like general text. And then second important is that they reflect the essential knowledge and the skills required of a risk management professional, and which are necessary for long-term success. Okay, so this is just why from the GARP, the purpose of changes. And then there was a FAQ attached to that document. So most of you, like the links were shared in the groups. So most of you must have like watched or read from those links. So there was one FAQ. So why is GARP making these changes? So question is why, and GARP is answering by what. So this is what we already know, and we are going to discuss. We will discuss this in detail. And for Part 2, GARP is telling you why, that because the treasury and the liquidity is a industry demand, and for that you need these changes. Like the reason for the introduction of the fourth subject on the in your FRM Part 2 curriculum. In this particular session, we are primarily discussing only FRM part 1 changes. So we are not focusing on the FRM part 2 changes because there are not substantial changes, because the pattern is the same, the way book is presented is the same, only one or two chapters introduced or deleted. So I will give you summary of that, summary as in one PDF file where you will find like everything added and deleted on one page. Okay, now FRM part 1's curriculum changes. So starting here, I will give you my analysis. So GARP's own curriculum is introduced instead of books reference. There are mergers and restructuring of topics and learning outcomes across all the books. Okay, so merger as in, like, say there is a single topic on CCP, now there is a single topic on CCP, like that. Okay, so Central Clearing Party and like that. Similar type of changes were made in across all the books, which we will see in detail. I will also show you books, their index, what are the changes. We also discuss index here. Then second is, a lot of new topics are introduced in and deleted, added as well as deleted in foundation and QA. Again, we will see what are these topics added and deleted. I will give you just overview of that. Then new questions section is added behind every topic. So question answer section is added behind every across all the four books and behind every topic. Additional explanations are added for all the books. Okay, so previously there were a few explanations missing here and there. Now those explanations are added there. Again, for FMP and VRM, GARP is sticking to old concepts but with the new sentence structuring. So what is the meaning of this statement? Previously, like, says example, in FMP the major section comes from the John C. Hull. So if you take John C. Hull's book and if you take GARP's curriculum book, you can relate that whoever was writing GARP's content was reading from that book. Okay, so you will find like this, the way the text is presented in GARP's book, new GARP's book, are a reflection of whatever was written in the John C. Hull's book. But again, it is not exact copy. It is written in a better manner. It is more simplified now. So the changes are good. This whole curriculum activity done by the GARP is really good, appreciable. And now you have to compulsory buy it at $25, which you already know. And similarities in the GARP book, first two column. So new books are also two column books where you get on the page. I will just show you what is a two column book. Again, like the previous books, 2019 and 2020, same. And then high word density and lengthy books. Again, these books are very lengthy. Same problem like before. Now, is reading curriculum time consuming? Yes. So I will just tell you like why I generally say this is very time consuming. So at present, as per this PDF which I have, the books which I have, FRM part 1, in foundation, actual pages are 157, 139 for QA, FMP 273, and VRM 219, okay, 219. Now these are two column pages. So one, if you have say one book where you have one column, now that one column becomes two columns, meaning there is a twice of the density compared to normal book. So effective pages which we generally use, like if based on the books we generally read, the effective pages are 314, 478, 547, and 438, totals to 177 pages. Meaning if you read from the GARP, it will, on an average, you will need around 222 hours average reading time. So this is just a basic reading time, the first reading time. This is based on, generally, this is because our GARP curriculum or this FRM curriculum is a technical document. All the concepts are technical. So the reading speed of a normal student or the average student is 8 pages per hour, which is really like assuming that he is good with the reading and he is understanding all the concepts on the first instance only. Okay, in the first reading only. So that's how it becomes 222 hours. Now you have to just, you do your calculation and see how reading GARP books fits your purpose. Right. Then how good are these changes? So this is my satisfaction. I'm telling you like how satisfied I am after seeing all these changes, and everything is divided category wise. because I always wanted these type of changes, and I will also upload one probability lecture which I recorded on 31st of November, okay, for the new batch, 2020 batch. And at that time, my thinking was like GARP will keep everything same, except they will add some explanations and they will restructure learning outcomes. So in that video, you will see that I'm saying, as per the old books, I said like I will not teach few things in the lecture probabilities. So chapter number 15, I was teaching chapter number 15. And in that chapter number 15 is a probability. And I was deleting few topics from Miller's probability. And exactly same thing is done by the GARP when they announced like their learning outcomes and everything on the 1st of December. So again, that topic was recorded on the like based on the old syllabus, but again it is relevant for the new syllabus as well, because I was of that opinion that these say the probability density, there are concepts like probability PDF, CDF, all those concepts are irrelevant in the probability section. It is very like overwhelming for the first chapter of your quantitative analysis. Again, same thing is done by the GARP. Now GARP moved that particular section, which I was not teaching in that probability lecture, to some another section, which again we will discuss. So first of all, the initiative. Initiative as in coming up with your own curriculum instead of recommending authors' readings. 100% satisfied. This is what is required, right? So it like previously, the thing was like recommending authors and all is very complicated process. Generally, authors write for the professionals. They don't write for the students, right? And those were the professional books, and those books were a bit difficult to read for a normal student. Now, because GARP is coming up with their own curriculum, and as the time passes, that curriculum will be improved after the suggestions. So the initiative is very good, 100% satisfied, nothing wrong with it. Then additions and deletions, around 60%. Satisfied around 70%, 70-75%. So there are additions and deletions in every subject, almost every subject, mainly in your foundations and quantitative analysis. So still I think like there are like few topics needs to be introduced and few topics needs to be deleted. Again, I will not discuss which are those topics. Again, it is because it is irrelevant for the video, but still there are chances of improvement. Okay, and this addition and deletion will keep on happening, which I think even in 2021 and later on, right? Then we have restructuring and merger. So as I've already explained you what is restructuring and merger. So again, I will reiterate whatever I told you. Like merger is when there are three topics. Again, I told you like, again, I will give a different example here. So in VRM, there were three topics in 2019 syllabus. There were three topics on the stress testing. Now those topics are merged into one, and now you have single topic on the merger. Okay, so this is the change in the VRM. So this is merger. What is restructuring? Restructuring is like there were few topics, okay, which were irregularly structured. So because there was author recommendations and like that was a problem. GARP used to recommend authors previously in 2019, and because of that recommendation, GARP had to keep that order. But now the complete order is restructured for the books, and now it is very, very good. Okay, so with the restructuring and merger, it is really good. Again, there are chances of few improvements, right? Again, we will not discuss that. 90% satisfied with that. Questions and answer. Hardly any efforts are taken on the questions and answer side by the GARP. You will find questions like just a one-liner questions are there behind the book, behind every chapter. And again, those questions are not substantial. You have to make sure you have your practice questions and separately. Okay, you will need everything separately, even if you try to use the GARP books. And then the explanations. So quite it is 50-50. So in a lot of areas, in a lot of topics, explanations are required. Much more explanations are required. And in most of the, like in many cases, the enough explanation is added before the concept. Okay. So on an average, like it is a good deal. So you will get benefited from the changes. Now effects of these changes on the subject. So here I'm explaining you like based on addition, deletion, mergers and explanations and total effect. How each subject is affected. So green is for foundations of risk management, book one, subject one. Then second is blue is for the quantitative analysis, which is a subject two. FMP is in yellow, subject 3, and VRM is in red. Okay. So first is, in case you are not able to read because the font is small, I'll just explain you what is the first chart. First is for the additions and deletions. So major additions and deletions are in first two subjects and not as such in your last two subjects. Now merger and restructuring, that is topics are merged and again restructured. It is not that evident in your first two subjects, still a bit higher in the foundation, very low in your quantitative analysis, very high in FMP and VRM. The major structuring, restructuring is in VRM. Then the explanations, like more explanations are added in the foundation and your quantitative analysis, and reasonable explanations are added in your FMP and VRM. Okay, so VRM is a bit untouched compared to FMP. Okay, then you have total effect. So in totality, first two subjects are highly affected and latter two subjects, that is FMP and VRM, are very less affected. Okay, compared to the first two subjects. Okay, now ebooks app review. After this ebooks app review, we will jump to actual books and then we will discuss the topic by topic. So see, first of all, how these books are provided. So you will get mail from GARP to access book, and you have to download app called Bookshelf, and that app will work in two devices, two mobile devices, that is mobile or iPad like the devices, and two Windows devices, and you can access it via browser. So how many access you are getting? Two Windows devices, two iOS or Android, and browser. Okay, so total five, we can say. Now the thing is, these are ebooks. It is very difficult to print these books. Why? Because you can print only two pages at a time. Once you, when you print those pages, your complete mail ID will be written as a watermark on those pages, and it is very difficult to read. So even if you want to read from printed copies, it is difficult. And if you want to read from the ebook, that is an application is not very stable. Okay. So not very stable as in I tried it in my Windows system. It is working okay. I tried in iOS device on iPad. It is working fine. But again, if you are not habitual of reading ebooks, then it will be a major problem for you if you want to use, or if you are planning to use your GARP books. Now, the first point is, it can be accessed on limited number of devices for the limited period. That is again for 2 years and 3 years, 2 years in offline, that is from the Android and the Windows devices, and from the browser, you can access it for 3 years, right? Why this logic? I don't understand. Now, the very problematic delivery method and the process of execution. Now, too much unnecessary protections are taken. Like, I will explain you why I'm saying this. Now, first of all, who are going to use, who are those people who will use these GARP books? So first of all, FRM Part 1 students, right? Now, every FRM Part 1 student is supposed to pay GARP $75 and he will get access to those books. Now, tell me, who are those people who will use pirated books now? Now, because every student is going to use, every student is paying for those books, and every enrollee is going to get those books. So what is the logic of protecting those books? Instead, GARP should give them these books in a PDF format so student can use them according to their use, right? So this is the thing. And at the end, like institute like us, we need to buy one copy of like books which from the books which we are using as a reference book. Okay, so that anyway we have to do. So we are anyway buying these books, right? So for students, at least these books should be available in the PDF format. So it will be better for them, the student. It will provide additional facility for the students. And anyway, you are charging all your students. Every student now needs to compulsorily pay $75. So there is no logic in like protecting the content anyway, like which is charged by the from students, right? So previously it was fine because there were few students who used to buy books and others might get it for free. So that's why like previously GARP was doing this. But again, I'm not satisfied with that. One more problem is, like, now books are not available, right? So books are available only to those who are enrolling. The problem with this is, the students who are planning to enroll before 31st Jan, okay, so near to 31st Jan, once they are confident about their preparation, okay, and they don't have any base material to prepare, because unless you enroll for the course, you are not going to get any material. So it is really big problem for them, right? Before that, like, what was the solution? Students used to access some old books, like say in 2019 session, they will start preparing using the 2018 sessions, because there were very limited changes. So they could use those books and decide if they want to appear for FRM or not. Now it is not possible, because the old books are not that useful. Still, if you just want to use it, you can use it, no problem. Still, there is a problem. But again, if you don't have any choice, you can. But I don't recommend it. Okay. To solve this problem, this is a very genuine problem. And to solve this problem, we are working on something right now. I cannot announce in this video on this date. I will come up with you the new notification or new update in 2 or 3 days for you. For those who are getting stuck in between like this, they don't have books and they need some content so that they can prepare and they can utilize their next 2 months. Now, the next problem is the only limited number of pages can be printed. Then printed copy is chargeable. Printed copy is chargeable as in you are first paying $75 for e-copy by default. Now, if you are not comfortable in this printing activity, because to print 900 pages, you have to give 450 commands. You have to wait for 450 times so that books get printed, because you can print only 2 pages at a time. So you click on print, it processes something, whatever, I don't know. And then after 1 minute, it gets like it prints something. And once it's printed, you have to start your activity and your whole day will be wasted in this printing. Now, if you want to buy printed books, again, it's costing $300. So again, the problem is this only. Then we have, it works well on the iOS, as I already told you. And then it works poorly on the Windows and the browser. It is very difficult to navigate in that book. It opens very weirdly in the environment and like that. Okay. So subject wise index. Okay, so this is your application. Okay, so this is a bookshelf application which we are accessing right now on Windows. We will first start with this is a content, this is an index file. Now here, to move right and left, it is not moving right and left, it is just moving up and down. Okay, so you have to click here and then it goes forward. You cannot annotate, like we have digital pen, those who are using say iOS devices have Apple Pencil and like that, they cannot annotate anything on the books. Okay, this does not support any pen inking facility. You can highlight it, but on Windows it is very difficult to highlight. I tried it, it is like you have to touch something twice, and now if you are highlighting frequently, you will end up like tapping your device again and again. Okay, on iOS it is like bit comfortable, you can just tap and select it. Okay, so let's start our index review. So first is your foundations of risk management. Okay, now previously in 2019, whenever I'm saying previously, I'm referring to 2019 session, and in this meaning 2020 session. So previously, the first chapter was a helicopter view of risk management. Now the content is approximately same. Explanations are changed. It is restructured. And the title is the building blocks of risk management. One as in the page number. Okay. Then your next chapter is how do firms manage financial risk. Again, it is kind of a new chapter. Content is mixed as in like combination of 2-3 chapters. Okay, so risk appetite, risk mapping and all, this is a kind of new content, and it is a mix of like new content, old topics and like that. Then we have the governance of risk management. This is a old topic written in new format with new case studies. Again, the conclusion is the same like the before. Then fourth chapter is the credit risk transfer mechanism. This is completely new chapter. Then we have modern portfolio theory and the CAPM, very valuable addition here. So previously, this section, the CAPM section used to start with this CAPM chapter only. But CAPM should start with modern portfolio theory. So before CAPM, there was modern portfolio theory. So around, say, in 1952, modern portfolio theory came. In around 1957, Sharpe, Linton and all those people produced CAPM using modern portfolio theory. So to understand CAPM in better manner, you need to understand modern portfolio MPT first, right? So it is a modern portfolio theory. Now we have modern portfolio theory's introduction and then CAPM's introduction. Again, MPT is not discussed in that detail. Like you should study it for a few pages, but here you have 2-3 pages only. Then you have the APT, the same old chapter. Previously there were two chapters on CAPM. So first chapter was CAPM, that is a concept introduction. The second chapter was the application of CAPM. Now you have single chapter on MPT, modern portfolio theory, CAPM and application of CAPM. So this first chapter is for everything. Then you have the second chapter in this section, that is the sixth chapter, arbitrage pricing theory, multi-factor models of the risk and return. So this is again the old chapter written in kind of a new format. But you can prepare CAPM, this particular section, using old books. Still, like, there are new concepts introduced here. Few. There is a like link between some different majors and like that. Then principles of effective risk aggregation and risk reporting. Same old chapter. No changes here. And then we have the enterprise risk management and future trends. So ERM, which was like second or third chapter in the 2019 session, previous session. Now it is 8th chapter. Then we have learning from the financial disaster. Major changes are here. So previously, this particular learning from the financial disaster was named as financial disasters. That's it. And the financial disaster used to start with your main cases. Now you have lots of cases. There is an introduction of Lehman Brothers, liquidity crisis, Continental is introduced and Northern Rock is introduced. Now these are new. Okay. So these were not present previously and chances are you will get question from this because there's a new introduction. Every institute likes to ask from the new content. Then you have like repetitions, like the case studies which were present before and some added case studies. So you can expect 50% old and 50% new now. Then we have anatomy of great financial crisis 2007-2009. In every time, starting 2015, the first time I saw GARP FRM books. So every time there was one chapter present which discusses 2007 and 9 crisis. Okay, 2007 crisis. So previously it was just a credit crisis 2007. In 2017, they came up, they deleted the credit crisis chapter and they came up with the two new chapters. Now they deleted two of these chapters. And now you have the single chapter, which discusses the anatomy of the great financial crisis 2007 and 2009. It is a bit more elaborative chapter. So it is discussing every aspect, like almost most of the aspects of the crisis. And then what happened in those 2 years. Okay. So good change here. Much appreciated, because those two chapters which were present in 2019 were not like up to the mark. Then you have like not in sync with each other. That was a problem. Now you have the GARP code of conduct. Again, obviously, I don't need to tell you like this is same or different. Every time it will be same only. Unless GARP makes changes in their code of conduct. Okay. Then you have book 2. Now book 2 starts with the fundamentals of probability. So In the same session, I told you, like, I recorded chapter number 15. Okay. And in that chapter, I deleted few sections and I kept the main area. The main area for this chapter is your conditional independence, the independence of the probability, conditional probability, joint probability and all those topics are discussed in here. Okay, so first it starts with the fundamentals of probability, that is the basic concepts are introduced. The second is the independence of the conditional probability and third is the Bayes rule. So previously Bayes chapter was different. Now it is merged with this particular chapter and only one page is discussed on the Bayes rule. Bayes is a really big concept, and that's why it cannot be discussed in detail in FRM curriculum because it will take your complete book. So that's why it is just discussed on one page. So you need to understand the basic concept of the Bayes. That's it. Which is, again, even if you see old lecture, I just checked with my old lectures which are available on the YouTube and the Bayes rule, which is discussed in here. So it is covering completely. Okay, so here you have one or two pages on the Bayes rule, and in that video, like the video which is present on the YouTube, I discuss Bayes rule in 20 minutes. So again, it is completely useful for you. So tomorrow, in 1 or 2 days, I will upload this probability lecture, fundamentals of probability, for you, so you can watch that. And then after this, I will also add whatever is extra content here. There are a few topics like this failure and all. So I will add this content in 15-20 minute session after this, okay, after probability. Then you have the random variables, kind of a basic statistics chapter, basic statistics, combination of basic statistics and the distribution, okay. And again, this change is very much appreciated because previously there was a big conflict between what to teach in basic statistics and what to teach in distribution, because all these topics, the probability, basic statistics and distribution, all these topics were so interlinked with each other. So I used to shift everything in the distribution section. Same thing is done here. Now you have the common univariate random variables. In simple words, it is a distribution chapter, but again, you have now extra content here. Okay, so old chapter is relevant, but if you prepare from the new book, it is better. I will also upload this particular chapter. I will upload till hypothesis testing, all the videos till hypothesis testing based on new syllabus on YouTube. Okay. And that too, as early as possible, like in this month only. Then we have a multivariate random variable. It is again the distribution's extension, but in multivariates. Then you have sample movements, very easy section. That is again the content of basic statistics, which is now removed in the sample movements. Previously, it was discussed in the basic statistics. So these first 5 chapters are the combination of probability, basic statistics, distribution, the Bayesian analysis. Then we have the separate chapter on the hypothesis testing. It is completely separate chapter like before, and it is more or less same. Then we have the linear regression. Previously, there were 4 chapters on the linear regression. Linear regression, hypothesis testing on the linear regression, multiple regression, and hypothesis testing on the multiple regression. Now we have 3 chapters. The first is the linear regression, which discusses the complete aspect of regression and the most important aspect, like which is application of this linear regression in CAPM, hedging, and other topics. Now, problem here is, like if you follow the order of book, like say if you start with book 1 then book 2, CAPM is discussed in book 1, but the basic concept which you need to understand CAPM is discussed here in linear regression. Okay, so that order is not followed by the gap. So ideally you should first understand the linear regression, and again we will come up with the study sequence like every year we come up with, we give you. So this time also you will get a study sequence, what will be the better sequence for your preparation if you are doing self-study. If you are taking classes from me, then you don't have to worry about it. I will again adjust all these topics in the proper sequence. Okay, now you have this linear regression part, then application of it, then we directly jump to multiple regression. Okay, multiple explanatory variables, that is a multiple regression, and this ends here. Then regression diagnostic, the kind of your hypothesis testing part of regression and mix of the miscellaneous topics which were covered previously in the hypothesis testing and the regression part. Okay, now you have 3 topics on it. Multicollinearity is extended, heteroscedasticity is extended, and rest is same. Okay, omitted variable bias and everything. Then you have the stationary time series and non-stationary time series, chapter number 10 and 11. So previously we had topics called like trend, seasonality, cyclicality, IRMA models and all. Now all those that particular content is deleted, okay, quashed, and you have new section, which is stationary time series. Now, this is very, very good presentation and ordering. Okay, so it starts with the stochastic process, then covariance, stationarity, white noise, every basic aspect which you need to understand, which you require to understand the stationary time series is discussed first, and then they are introducing AR and MA model, right? And then you have the non-stationary time series. GARP reduced the size of forecasting seasonality. See here. So it is just few pages, one or two pages. Then you have the non-stationary time series. And in non-stationary time series also, you can see just one page on the seasonality. Again, the thing here is that time series, the econometrics section of the quants is really big section. It cannot be discussed in detail in FRM curriculum. Okay, so that's why there are only two chapters. These chapters are kind of introduction for you. Introduction of econometrics. You can treat it as introduction of econometrics. And even GARP is not expecting you to understand, like go or dive deep into these chapters. It is just a wastage of time. Once you finish your FRM curriculum, once you become certified FRM, take out 6 months time, prepare econometrics properly. Okay. So this is a really, like, if you want to give justice to this particular section, you have to do this. So we are coming up with new R sessions and Python sessions on the econometrics soon, which will be available for students only, not for everyone. Then you have measuring returns, volatility and correlation. This is a previous correlation volatility chapter. Then you have the simulation, the bootstrapping, again, old simulation topic. And this ends here. Okay. So your subject two is over. Then we have subject number three. Okay. So subject number three is more or less same in number of concepts and the concepts which are discussed in this particular section. But the difference here is, like previously, the order was different. Now you have completely different order. There is one problem with this order. I will explain you what is the problem. Now we will first start with these things. Okay, so the banking, same as before, but not exactly same. The explanations are different here, but the broad concept is same. Insurance companies and pension plan, again, broad concept is same, but inside explanations which are given inside are changed. Then fund management, again, similar chapter. Like all those strategy types of hedge funds and strategies followed by the hedge funds are there. But again, these strategies are now better explained compared to previous book. Okay, previous session. Now, introduction to derivatives. Again, previous discussion, exchange and OTC markets. Same. Central clearing. Now, previously, there were four chapters on the central clearing. One in same area, that is after your future forwards, which was discussing like CCPs for central clearing for 2-3 pages, and then there were four chapters on CCP. Okay, in the end of the chapter, in the subject. Now all those four chapters are merged into one, and now you have single chapter on central clearing. So you can expect more number of questions on this, more as in one to two maximum. Okay, then you have the futures market, which is again theoretical discussion, pricing and all those things. Then you have using futures for hedging. And then foreign exchange market. Then foreign exchange market is same, but here the interesting part is now the quotes are introduced. Previously the quotes were missing. So direct, indirect quote, future quotes, and how these rates are quoted, which was very important discussion I used to cover in my videos. If you watch the forex video, like you will find, like I'm discussing the direct indirect quotes for foreign exchange topic, which was not there in the previous syllabus. Now it is there. Now we have that part. Again, everything is very well structured in the foreign exchange. I really liked it. Then you have the pricing, financial forwards and the futures. Now I said, like, I have one particular problem with this structuring. The problem is, like, when you will reach to this financial price, the pricing of the financial forwards and the futures chapter, by this time, if you are just following the simple order, you are not aware, you will not be aware of the interest rate part. And interest rate part is most important part for the futures pricing, because futures pricing's fundamental logic is the interest effect on the spot value. So Again, if it is you are not aware with the like what is continuous compounding, how to use the exponential for continuous to effective and all those things, it will be very, very difficult to understand, right? So again, we will do something for that. Again, obviously in classes, I will change the structure of this for like in 10% cases. But if you are doing self study, we will find out some solution in that sequence guide, okay, to make sure that you are well prepared. Now, one good link is here. The pricing of the financial forwards and the futures is directly now connected with the commodity forwards and the futures. So you have back to back two chapters. If you watch old sequence guide, I did exactly same. Then you have the options market. Again, the same old chapter, properties of stock options, same old chapter, trading strategies, same old chapter, exotic options, same old chapter. Explanations are changed, some content is added. I'm just telling you, like, overall the content is same, okay, theme is same. And then properties of interest rate is added here. So if you want to prepare forwards and the futures and everything, first finish this properties of interest rate, okay? Then you have, after this properties of interest rate, you have corporate bonds. Really good initiative, because see what used to happen before, like, you like student used to start interest rate futures and all these chapters where the bonds are introduced, okay? And there was no discussion on the bonds. Now you have proper discussion on the bonds. Bonds are discussed theoretically in detail properly, and MBS is very well structured now. You have better presentation, you have better content organization and new explanations in MBS, okay? Then interest rate futures, again the same old chapter. And software is introduced here. Previously there was no software. Swaps, same, there is nothing to change in swaps actually. Okay, so this is your FMP. Now the last subject number 4, valuation and risk models, VRM. The subject is not war. Stop calling it war. There are only 3 chapters on in this subject which are based on war. Rest is valuation and risk model. Subject is VRM, not war. Remember this. Okay. Then financials of risk, measures of financial risk, same old chapter. Calculating and applying war, same discussion. So if you take first 3 chapters on war, these 3 chapters are same as before, but now well structured, well organized, and with a better explanation. Then you have the external and the internal credit rating. This was like kind of a miscellaneous chapter in this book. Now it is in the chapter number 4. It is becoming important. Country risk. If you see the layout or the these like main headings, you can relate this particular section directly to Aswath Damodaran's country risk. Okay, so like which was recommended in 2019. Now you have measures of credit risk measures. Okay, measuring credit risk, not credit risk measures. So measuring credit risk is new introduction, complete new introduction in your FRM part 1 curriculum. Similar chapter, I guess, is added in the foundations as well. So these two topics, like this is the attempt by the GARP to introduce you with the credit risk in the FRM part 1 only. This is not very extensive. This is just a 7-9 pages discussion here, but still useful. You will be like comfortable with the credit risk. And anyway, you have to study full subject on the credit risk in FRM part 2. Doesn't like affect much. Then you have the operational risk part. In operational risk, you have same old syllabus, but a lot of new things are added here. Okay, so same old content plus new things. Then you have the stress testing. As I've told you, like in stress testing, like there were 3 chapters before. Now all those chapters are merged into one. And this is now better structured chapter. Okay, so you will find this stress testing chapter much more relevant compared to old 3 chapters. Then you have, this is like from chapter 9, your fixed income portion starts. One more thing is here, like there are 2 sections. Now in our syllabus, we have 2 sections on fixed income. Okay, the first section is in FMP, those last few chapters, okay. That is interest rate and swaps and all. This is fixed income. And in VRM also, you have fixed income. Okay. VRM's subject is valuation and risk models. This first, pricing convention, discounting and arbitrage. There is nothing like model here. Okay. So these first 3 chapters can be shifted to FMP. So GARP can consolidate all these three chapters or five, six, seven chapters on one location in any one subject and name it as a fixed income section. Okay, then you have the interest rate, then bond yields and returns and calculations, same old chapters. Then applying duration, convexity, and DV01. So see here, till this chapter in fixed income, everything is more or less same. Okay, the only difference is modeling non-parallel term structure shifts and the hedging. This is your old multi-factor risk model chapter. Again, this is kind of again multi-risk chapter, multi-risk only, multi-risk factor only. But here it is sorry, multi-factor risk model only. But here it is a bit properly structured. Okay, then you have most loved chapters, binomial trees, BSM, and Greeks. Why these chapters are shifted in the end, I don't know. Like these chapters were better in the beginning only, because see, the basic thing is, like by the time students reach to end of syllabus in any curriculum, not just in FRM, even if you remember your school days or your any college days or whenever you are doing degree and undergrad and all. So if you try to remember, you will always recall that last few topics we used to skip or we used to avoid or due to time or some other compulsions. And same might happen with these three topics. And the thing is, these three topics are very, very important. Even in 2019, these topics were important. Like around five, six questions were there in 2019 exam. So yeah, so better these topics should come in the beginning of this subject. Okay, subject is proper, but it should not be in the end. So this is the introduction of your all four chapter four subjects. So what happened here? My recommendation is, in like if you want to start your preparation early, like first of all, I would recommend you to start slowly. Okay, don't rush in your preparation, because anyway, we have to work on the books, we have to give you study notes and all everything. By the time your study notes are ready, it will take, even for the one book, it will take around 20, 30 days. 20 days, sorry, 20th December. Now, if you start with this, if you want to start with your old books, start with FMP. Okay, so do one thing, finish time value of money from your old books, and after time value of money, jump to your FMP section and finish FMP section. If in case, like if it is compulsory for you to utilize, say, next 1 month. Why I'm saying this, like I have, like this batch has already started for 2020, and I have few students who are going to get leave of say 15 days, because a lot of banks and all, like companies, give 15 days leave in December for Christmas and some another audit purposes and all. So for those, like for those type of students, if you want to utilize, go with this plan. Time value of money, you will finish time value of money section, and after that you will start FMP section one by one, just finish it. Okay, or if you want to avoid time value of money, simply start with interest rate section, interest rate chapter in FMP, which is around chapter number 39 or 37 as per the old syllabus. Okay, I'm telling you this because I guess you have old books only now at this point. But better you start a systematic preparation. We are coming up with something for those who want to start early, okay, with the notes and videos and all. Okay, so all new classes, we'll update you about it. That's all. This is all like information for your new updates. In case you have any doubts and you want to ask me personally, so this is my contact number. Prefer WhatsApp. Okay, and please ask questions which are not publicly available. Like, don't ask me what is a fees and all. I don't know all those things, exam fees and all. If you have any good question to ask relating to FRM and your admissions and career and all, you can ask on this number. I'll just rewrite the number again. 9096131868. Okay, so very simple. So that's all about your new amendments and updates on the FRM in FRM curriculum. So thank you very much. Thank you for your time.